Welcome to the first episode in the Bitcoin Lecture Series. The Bitcoin Lecture Series is a series of podcasts and videos sharing the talks and panels we have at events held by the Bitcoin Association of Hong Kong with the global Bitcoin and blockchain communities. I'm your host, Larry Salibra, co-founder of the Bitcoin Association of Hong Kong. In this episode, we'll be sharing a recording of a talk we organized and hosted with the Tuspark Global Network on March 16th, 2016. We were very lucky to have Bitcoin Core contributor Dr. Johnson Lau on site to explain segregated witness to us. Johnson holds a PhD in public health and is a statistician that teaches at a medical school here in Hong Kong. He's been involved in Bitcoin for the past 4 years and is closely involved in the development of the Bitcoin protocol. He was a key player in the Bitcoin Roundtable held here in Hong Kong in February of 2016, helping to bridge the gap between miners and developers to reach consensus. Johnson is also the co-author of BIPs 141, 142, and 143. I apologize in advance for the poor quality of the audio. It was recorded with little planning on my iPhone from the audience. In the future, we'll try to do a better job at capturing audio. If you're watching the video, you'll see the amazing slides Johnson prepared. If you're listening to the podcast, you can find the slides linked from the podcast notes or on our website and follow along. If you'd like to keep up with our future events or get involved, you can visit our website, bitcoinhk.org, for more information. You can also follow me on Twitter at Larry Salibra, LarrySalibra, or subscribe to the newsletter I write about blockchain and decentralization on my website, larrysalibra.com/newsletter. Now sit back, relax, and enjoy Johnson's talk.
This evening, I'm trying to use some really simple language and avoid too much technical language. Probably that might be too simple for some of you. I try to explain why we would like to have segregated witness. What is the Bitcoin transaction? What is the problem? What is transaction vulnerability? And why segregated witness is a solution, and what is the bonus of doing segregated witness. So Bitcoin transaction is like a check. So you have some money coming from somewhere and sending it to some people. So in this example, Alice is a miner, so she mined a block, and therefore she claimed that she has 25 Bitcoin. So this is the protocol allows her to create some Bitcoin just by mining. So since this money is coming from nowhere, so it does not require a signature to issue this check. So this is a really special one. But after the Bitcoin is mined, Alice can pass it on, sending it to other people. So very interesting, in Bitcoin, you are not going to write down where is the money from. Instead, you will have a picture. Okay, it's like you take a picture of the original check and put it here as to show where the money is coming from. And sending to Bob with the same amount, and here you have the signature of Alice because the money belongs to Alice, so you require Alice's signature. So everyone who see this check will verify the signature and make sure this is coming from Alice. So if all people are satisfied, they will have such a check, and the Bitcoin bank, which is basically the mining network, accept it, and therefore the value will be transferred from Alice to Bob. So if we use some, we use a Bitcoin technical language, this part would be what we call the out point, where the money is coming from. To somebody, this we call it the script pub key. The amount is the value, the signature is the script sig. And also we have the date, we call it the lock time, which means this check is not valid before the date. Okay, so it's quite similar to the chat in the real world. And similarly, Bob can send the money to another person. Of course, he cannot send more than 25 because he only has 25. If he sends less than 25, then some of them, the rest of them will become the thief or the miners. So etc. People can pass it on. So you can see we could have a chain of transaction like this. But very interestingly, although it is really, really small, you can see that here is a tiny blue square here, which is actually coming from here. That means if this check is invalid, all the subsequent checks are not valid. So we have to confirm this check one by one. You can't do it in the other way. Okay. So when you have a chain of transaction, it depends. Each one depends on the earlier one. And Bitcoin transactions could be very, very flexible. You could not only send to a single person, but instead you may send to multiple persons. For example, we have something like M of N multi-signature. In this example, it is 2 of 3 multi-signature. That means you will require 2 signatures out of the 3 persons, Carl, Dave, and Avi. So any 2 of them will be able to spend these 25 bitcoins. So here you will have the signature of Carl and Avi, and this check will be valid. Or even you can send your money to anyone. You do not specify the name of the recipient. So because the money is sent to anyone, you don't really need a signature to spend it. And that means anyone who have this check will be able to claim the amount. But of course you can't double spend it because each check could only be spent once only. So David is trying to get the Bitcoin, Edwin is trying to get a Bitcoin, Fanny is trying to do it. But in the most likely scenario, the miner who will actually decide which check is valid will take the Bitcoin. So you will expect that a smart miner will do it. So the others will become invalid because the others will be considered as double spending. Okay, so what is transaction vulnerability? In Bitcoin terminology, that means the transaction ID of a transaction may be changed by the payer, the people who draft and sign the check, or even by any other people before the transaction is confirmed by the miner. After the transaction is confirmed, it is not possible to change the transaction ID, but you can always do it before it is confirmed, not only by the payer, but also by any other person. So using the check example, that means the appearance of a check may change by the payer or any other person before it is confirmed by the bank. So I will have more examples later, but there are 2 types of transaction vulnerability. I would try to classify in 2 ways. Okay, the vulnerability by the payer. So basically, it is double spending. People trying to double spend the same transaction, the same way. Okay, so there could be many different reasons for having double spending. That could be malicious or that could be legitimate, but this is not our concern today. The point is the payers always have the ability to double spend the Bitcoin until it is confirmed. So it is not something fixable. Actually, the Bitcoin protocol is to fix this problem by mining. So without mining, any Bitcoin transactions are not safe. So the any unconfirmed transaction is not safe unless we really trust the payer. So this is not really, we are really trying to fix, okay, because it is basically not fixable. So the what we are trying to fix is the archetype, the malleability by any other person, that is involuntary for the payer. So even the payer cannot control it. So it comes from what we call signature malleability. This the form of the signature may be changed before the transaction is confirmed. So this is possible for mainly for two reasons. First of all, it is because of the mathematical property of the digital signature. So you can have some mathematical transformation and make the same signature, you change the form, but it is still valid. And also the other reason is the flexibility of Bitcoin Swift's language. You can add some extra operation code in this signature, but it will still make it valid. Or we just have an example, you have many different ways to code a zero in the Bitcoin Swift language. It's the same thing. So you can just replace, for example, if you have a zero as part of your signature, you can replace it with another form of zero. So it's still valid. So any people can do that. So that is involuntary malleability. So using the check example like this, so all these checks are valid. Okay, so this is an original one, and you may try to put some small dots here which are not really very obvious, so the bank will still accept it, or you have a bigger pen, or you have a bigger signature. All of these checks are valid, even in our daily experience. But the problem is only one of them could be confirmed, because the others are just basically a double spending of the confirmed transaction. So why transaction malleability is a bad thing we want to avoid? The first reason is the transaction ID is not final until the transaction is confirmed. So it is not very similar to our daily experience, because whenever you made a transaction in e-banking, for example, they give you a transaction ID, and usually you expect that would be final. You can, if you have any problems regarding the transaction, you have the ID and you call your bank to follow up the transaction. But in Bitcoin, the transaction ID they gave you, for example, you withdraw money from the exchange, and they will give you a transaction ID, but that ID is not really final, and then it change. And if that change, people may be confused, because they may think that although eventually they will still receive the money, but the problem is the ID is changed, and they are not sure whether it is really coming from the exchange. So 2 years ago, there was a huge transaction vulnerability attack on the network, and Mongols actually they claimed that this problem cost them 850,000 Bitcoin. They claimed it was due to the transaction vulnerability, and that confused the system, and they double pay the customers. Of course, many people do not really believe this is a real reason, but we did have a very serious attack at that moment. So many, I think when it was most serious, I think more than 50% of the transaction on the network were, the ID was changed before the confirmation.
Did Mt. Gox ever do a write-up of what exactly they claimed happened and what went wrong there? The transaction malleability that led to loss?
They claimed that it was they send money out to the customer. But before it was confirmed, the ID was changed. And some customer complains to them and saying that they do not receive the money, and actually they also so they from their system they also cannot find the transaction because it becomes a double spend. So they claim
The recipient of the money, the one who withdrew, reintroduced the same transaction with valid signature with a changed transaction ID into the system, which got mined. Then complained to Mt. Gox that the original reported transaction ID never confirmed. Mt. Gox looks it up, sees it never confirmed, goes, oh my god, that money never went out, didn't actually check the address it came from, and then send it again.
Yeah.
That's pretty stupid.
I personally don't believe in this theory.
I'm able to believe that their systems were that bad and that that did happen. It seems weird that would have caused the entire amount. At some point, somebody should have noticed that they had a lot less that they should have had. Oh well.
But even that they may lose some Bitcoins, I don't think it's just 800,000. It's just ridiculous.
I think you should notice before you go bankrupt that money's vanishing from your accounts.
Yeah. So anyway, we did have a big trouble at that time, not only for the customer of Mongols, but actually for everyone, because the attack is just for everyone. It's not really targeting Mongols. But this, even for this one, is not actually, I would say, it's not the biggest problem, because the money will eventually get confirmed, and no one will actually lose any money because of this problem. But the other problems are more important. First of all, when you have a chain of unconfirmed transaction, it is actually unsafe, because as I mentioned, every transaction is dependent on the previous transaction. And if the transaction ID is changed, then all the subsequent transactions will become invalid. So you cannot have a long chain of unconfirmed transactions. And actually, many smart contracts will require something like that. And you cannot do really sophisticated transactions if we do not fix the transaction liability problem. And the third one is also kind of, is quite stupid, because you cannot construct a chain of transaction without first signing an earlier transaction. That means in our daily life, that means if you are going to buy an apartment, you have to pay. You have to pay all the deposit irreversibly before you can sign any contract. So the counterparty may never sign the contract after they get the money, they may just run away. But this is actually how things happen in Bitcoin with transaction liability. So and even if you fully trust your counterparty, the first two problems is still there because due to the involuntary liability. So going back to our example of a chain of transaction, a chain of check. So this one, the green one is dependent on the blue one, the yellow one dependent on the green one, etc. So the yellow one is valid only if the green one is also valid. So in case the signature is modified a little bit, but is still valid, then and this check is being confirmed, then this check will become an invalid double standing, and therefore all the subsequent checks will become invalid. So that's why if we have transaction malleability, the unconfirmed transaction chain will be unsafe because anyone can do this. They just take a copy of this transaction and change the signature a little bit, and but still keeping it valid and get it confirmed. So, well, actually, this is exactly what happened for Mongox, because they pay the customer and they use the same we call it the UTXO, the output to pay another customer. So they really did it like this, and if this one is the ID is changed, then all the subsequent chain will become invalid. So that's really what happened. And also the other problem I just mentioned is you cannot really create a chain of transaction in a safe way. So for example, we have a scenario here. Alice is going to pay, Alice is paying 25 Bitcoin to Bob, but only if Bob agrees to pay this amount to Carl later. Okay, so this is what she wants to do. Okay, so could she do it safely? So I would try to suggest some method, but I think none of them would really work. So the first method is Alice will create a green check here, paying to Bob, but she is not signing it. So this is not valid because there is no signature. Then Bob creates a yellow check, paying the money to Carl, and sign it, okay. But this one is not valid because this one is not valid. So both checks are invalid because there is no signature here, and this and the yellow one is based on the green one, so the chain is invalid. So this method does not work. Okay, the other method is again. Alice creates the green check but not signing it, so it is invalid at this moment. Then Bob creates the yellow check and sign it, again it is invalid because the green one is not valid, so the yellow one is not valid. And now Alice signs the green check, so it becomes valid. So what happened next? The yellow check is still invalid because the yellow check is based on the unsigned check. So they are not the same thing. So this one is still invalid. So Bob is still not paying this amount to Carl because this thing is invalid. So this does not work. Okay, so the last method I would like to suggest. Okay, Alice just creates a green check and sign it, and it is valid. She pays 25 bitcoins to Bob. Bob may just take the money and run away because he has no method in the protocol to mandate him to sign another check and pass on the value. So basically, you cannot do the scenario paying one person and ask the person to pay another person later. It's basically impossible, and it's just like you cannot sign a contract before you pay the contract, before you pay all the money.
Couldn't you do it by more level of indirection? I mean, the basic problem is Bob needs a signed check from Alice, a fully signed check with where the transaction ID is no longer going to change, to make his check out and have it valid.
Yeah.
But that it would still work if that signed Alice check was not yet spendable. because it's based on an earlier transaction that Alice hasn't broadcast.
Yeah.
That is also signed.
Yes. You mean based on the transaction ID?
Yeah.
So Bob does not really have the transaction of the
Well, Bob, so there would be another check in front of this one. Alice makes a check out to herself for 25 and signs it, mm-hmm. and keeps it in a drawer, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And she makes the check out to Bob, spending that check. Shows it to Bob, Bob knows he's getting the money, Bob does his check, spending to Carl, shows it to Alice, who at that point broadcasts her initial check, which makes the second check valid, which makes Bob's check valid.
Mm-hmm.
With the basic trick being that Alice has a transaction to herself that she doesn't broadcast, so the chain is already there and fully signed, it's just Bob can't spend his money because the network doesn't yet think it's valid.
Do I remember this wrong?
Isn't it the same problem though? Then she broadcasts the first check to herself, someone changes the transaction ID,
Have the problem with the transaction IDs. Yeah. I'm just saying, this isn't actually something we can't do. It's just we can't do it safely currently.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
With those segregated agreements, we cannot do it, actually.
Okay.
So this is the solution, sort of a permanent solution to involuntary mortality. We call it segregated agreements. So it is proposed by the Bitcoin Core developer, Peter Wu. He presented in Hong Kong last December. So first of all, I would like to introduce what is weakness, okay? So it is a cryptography term. We can consider that there is a transaction could be divided into two parts. We have some base data. The base data basically tells you where the money is coming from and where the money is going. So in this example, you have from money is coming from here, sending to Carl, and the amount is this one, and it is valid after this date. And the other part of the check, we call it the witness data. So the witness data is the information to verify the correctness of the base data. So here, the witness is basically the signature. So we actually have two types of data in a transaction. And originally Satoshi, he put everything together in one transaction. You have both base data and witness data. But now with segregated witness, we will separate. So we separate the base data and the witness data and deal with them separately. And how does it solve the problem? So we have some new rules introduced with segregated witness. So with SegWit, instead of paying to Alice, we pay to something like this. We pay to anyone, SegWit Alice. Okay, so of course this is just an example, not really how it happens in the protocol level. So you pay to anyone, SegWit Alice. So now Alice have received some Bitcoin, and when she wants to spend the money, she is not allowed to sign on the check. Okay, so this is a rule. Okay. Instead, she will sign on a separate paper and attach the paper with the signature to her check. Okay, so she is still to provide signature, but not directly on the check. So for those people who enforce the new rules, who understand the new rules, they will still verify the signature, because they know the money is actually belongs to Alice, SegWit Alice. but not to anyone. Because if it is saying to anyone, we don't really need anything to understand. And we also have another rule that if the signature field on the check is not exactly blank, people who enforce the new rule will reject the check. That means you cannot put anything in the signature. So you, and therefore you won't have any involuntary malleability, because anything you try to put in the signature would make the whole thing invalid. But also, there are some people who may not upgrade, and or they do not, they simply do not understand the new rules. So what would happen, or in their perspective, the check is still valid, because they would find that the money was sent to anyone, and therefore they would not require any signature. So because they find that the money is sent to anyone, and Alice has nothing on the sign on the check, and is perfectly fine for them, because the money is in these people's perspective, they don't, the money is spendable without any signature. And they simply don't understand what is said with Alice, and they will just ignore it. And they will also don't see the real signature, which is on a separate paper that they will not see. Okay. So so this is how it works. Without segregation meters, people you send every mine a block, and he find 25 bitcoins, and he then later he sends the money to Fanny, and he signed on the check, and Fanny send the money to Gary, and also she signed the check. So this is the original, our existing system. With SegWit, then they will send the money to anyone, SegWit admin, and when admin try to send the money out, he will sign on a separate paper and do not sign here. And people who understand the new rules, they will verify the signature, the admin is really matched with this one. And later, when Fanny wants to spend it again, she will do the same thing. And also you can see that there is no signature here, okay? Because this picture is taken from here. So because there is no signature here, and therefore you don't have the signature here. And in the original system, you will have the signature here. So both would be valid, because for people who do not understand the new rules, they will just think the money belongs to anyone, and they will not require any signature on the check. Okay, so just want to remind you that we have two types of malleability. Signature malleability, which is mostly involuntary, and double spending, which could only be done by the payer. So with segregation meters, the signature malleability becomes irrelevant. Okay, so you still have signature malleability. You can still change the form of the transaction. The form of the signature, but that becomes irrelevant because the check itself still not exactly the same, even if the signature is changed. So the transaction ID is not changed. So the you cannot change the transaction ID by modifying the signature. So so signature malleability becomes irrelevant, and the double spending would become the only type of transaction malleability possible. But again, as I mentioned, it is not fixable. But we can have some other method to deal with this problem. For example, we may use multi-signature to prevent some unexpected double spending by your counterparty. So I will have the example later. And with segregated means, we can also construct a chain of transaction without first signing an earlier transaction. So again, I will tell you more in the coming examples. So why transaction ability won't break the transaction chain? Because even the signatures are different. Okay, so only one of these could be confirmed because they are basically double standing of the same check. But no matter which one is confirmed, it won't change the appearance of the check. These two parts look exactly the same, and therefore this one will remain valid. Okay, and we go back to our example, the scenario. So now Alice is paying 25 bitcoins to Bob, though only if Bob agrees to pay the amount to Carl later. However, Alice worries that Bob will just take the money and refuse to send it to Carl, and she will use Segwit and two of two multi-signature to fix the problem. So how could we do it? First of all, Alice has 25 bitcoins in a Segwit address, and it is already confirmed. So the money is sending to anyone Segwit Alice. That means Alice has that money, which is 25 Bitcoin. And then Alice will create another check, the green one, sending these 25 Bitcoin to this address. Okay. Again, this is a Segwit address. Anyone, Segwit 2 of Alice and Bob, which means if you want to spend the money, you need the signature of both Alice and Bob. But here, she is not attaching any signature. And therefore, at this moment, this check is invalid because this check would require Alice's signature. And then based on this green check, Alice and Bob will create a yellow check and sending 24.99 Bitcoin to Carl and sign it. And they sign it on a separate paper because this is a Segwit transaction. At this moment, the yellow check is invalid because the green check is not signed. There is no signature attached. So this one is still invalid, and therefore this one is also invalid. After Alice see the signature from Bob here, now she can safely sign this check and attach the signature to it. So this one will become valid because it has Alice's signature, and since this is valid, and then this will also be valid. So now you really created a chain of transaction. Alice is paying 25 Bitcoin to Bob only if Bob agrees to pay the money to Carl later, on a later day. And this check is not yet valid, actually, because the date is in the future. Okay, but after the 18th of March, that will become valid. And we also have a bonus here. If both Alice and Bob agrees, they can actually sign another check before 18th of March and send the money to someone else. But it is only possible with the consent of both Alice and Bob. So they can basically invalidate this check and send the money to somewhere else, maybe sending it back to Alice or anything they want to do. The main purpose of segregatedness is to fix the problem of transaction vulnerability, but it also brings a lot of bonus. Mm-hmm. So first of all, we with segregatedness, we can actually increase the maximum block size from currently 1 megabyte to effectively around 1.75 to 4 megabytes, depends on the type of signature or the type of transactions in the block. So I think most of you would know that we have a very big debate about the block size issue, and segregatedness is proposed as one of the short-term solution to increase the block size. So how does it work? Because since the witness data is not visible to existing software, these data will not be counted in the block size limit, and it is basically invisible to existing software, and they won't count it in the 1 megabyte. And therefore, we can have extra space for more base data. So after we have SegWeek, we will only have if people all people are using SegWeek, we will only have base data in the block, and all witness data, all the signature will be removed from this 1 megabyte limit, and therefore effectively we increase the block size. And therefore, we will allow more transactions in the block. And because we are doing it as a software, that means all the existing transaction format will still work as the same way as before. And therefore, the upgrade is only mandatory for miners who are actually validating the transactions. So if you do not upgrade your wallets, everything will still work as usual, but yes, of course, you won't have any protection against the vulnerability problem. And people can still send money between upgraded and non-upgraded wallets without any problem. But if you upgrade your wallet, you would expect to have some discount in your transaction fee by about 50%. It depends on the type of your transaction, because the witness data will actually be cheaper because it is not invisible to existing software. Yes.
See, I've got an upgraded mobile wallet and I send a new SegWeek transaction to you,
mm-hmm.
and you haven't upgraded your wallet. Will you see the incoming?
No, but actually it shouldn't happen, because when you say you send money to me, before that I have to give my address to you, right? So the address, if it is not a SegWeek address, you cannot send me by SegWeek actually. So it just can't happen actually. Yeah, you have some special address, not really special. I will talk about it later. The user experience,
On the website, will they show the new SegWeek address or the old address? So say you buy something online in an e-commerce, so the address that comes up, how do I know whether to show you an old one or a new one?
Well, you don't really care, because if you are the customer, you want to buy something with Bitcoin, the store will give you an address, and you just pay to it. You don't really care whether that address is SegWeek or not, because if you are upgraded, you will enjoy the discount, not the shop, not the store. So if they don't upgrade, it won't affect you.
actually. It won't affect you, but they will not enjoy any benefits of recycling, but you will still enjoy it.
What if they upgrade and the customers don't upgrade?
No problem, because they will give you an address, but the address is, you can still pay to the address. It is actually transparent to you. I will tell you more about it later, about the user experience. With segregated witness, we can also make the transmission and storage of the witness data becomes optional. So currently, because Satoshi made everything in the same format, I mean, you have base data and witness data in the transaction, and therefore you cannot just take part of it out of the transaction. Just like the chat, you cannot just remove the signature. You have to send it at one piece. But after we have segregated readers, the transmission and storage of witness data will become optional, because you only really need the base data to tell the full history of transactions. It's just like your bank statement you receive every month. It will only tell you how many money you have, who sent you, and you are sending to some other people. They won't actually show the signature in your bank statement, right? Because you won't really care. The only person who cares is the bank. They have to validate the signature, make sure everything is correct.
Does this mean, though, that if I look back on the blockchain after segregated witness, when it was introduced, I can no longer verify that all of these transactions were actually valid at the time they happened? I have to rely on it sort of anyway, I guess, but I'm basically relying on proof of work in the longest chain and the fact that somebody at that time correctly verified these things and saw the signatures for them.
Yeah, I would say that becomes optional, because you expect that some people will still keep the signature, keep the witness data, and you can request it.
Okay, I guess.
So if you want to validate, you can request for it.
So where would this witness data go in the protocol?
It's still stored in the same file. I think Peter Wood is still going to store everything, including the witness data in the existing files, those .blk files. All the witness data will still be stored there. So if you want to validate, you can request for it. But if you don't want to validate, you can skip it.
But then how do I save? So the thing I'm confused on is, we are saying this gets around, I mean, when does this data get stripped out? When does it suddenly no longer become, when is it suddenly no longer considered part of the block? When do I get the advantage of not having it counted towards the block limit? Like, where does the magic happen where formerly signature data vanishes but doesn't vanish? So what you're basically saying, well, what the way this has arrived at my brain is, we're saying we're putting signatures somewhere extra.
Yeah.
All the transactions suddenly look like they're spendable by anyone.
Yeah.
Except everybody who understands some new magic knows that they actually need to verify a separate piece of data.
Mm-hmm.
This piece of data won't count towards the block limit.
Yes.
But it'll still be in the protocol, it'll still be stored and retrievable. And I think that combination...
Well, if you do not upgrade your nodes, so let's say if you are running a full node today, and you do not upgrade it, you will not receive any witness data. Because even if you get it, you won't understand it. So you will see a lot of anyone can spend transaction.
Yeah,
there.
That's what I see.
So if only if you do not upgrade it. If you upgrade,
sure. That's what happens.
Yeah, if you upgrade, then you will still request all the witness data and do all the validation.
So locally. Where does the witness data enter into the protocol?
They will use another transaction serialization format to carry these extra witness data.
I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think that the reason we say it doesn't count with the block limit is because the concern is that the miners have very slow connections and they don't want to increase the orphan rate by having to send bigger blocks. And so when you, correct me wrong, when you, the miner finds the blocks, they broadcast that new block but without the witness data, right?
They may do that.
They may do that.
They may do that.
And then,
I expect that they will do that.
And that lets them have more transactions in like the same megabyte because they're not broadcasting the witness data and it doesn't affect their, you know, their orphan rate.
And the miner and the nodes who haven't upgraded don't see the witness data but still find the block to be valid.
Sure,
so
sure, because it's all spent anyway.
Find it somewhere.
Yeah, miners has to upgrade anyway, otherwise they can't mine, could they?
Well, they could still do it, but that's
I mean, really risky.
If no miner upgrades, then we're suddenly all spending our money, sending our money spend anyone. All the miners are happily mining blocks full of spend anyone transactions, and nobody knows what the hell is going on.
Yeah, but of course we require the threshold will be as usual 95% of mining pushing power to activate segregated miners. Yes, I think that's right. After this is implemented, some miners may just skip the witness data, at least initially, when they find a block, they want to spread it out as quick as possible, and they may skip it. But eventually, they still have to propagate the data, the witness data, because otherwise, other people cannot validate, other full nodes cannot validate the block, and they may still reject the block, and therefore. In longer time frame, not the first few seconds. I mean, after a few minutes, the witness data will still be propagated to all the them.
But then,
can we save some questions for later? Because I think it's easier if we wrap it up.
So what is the benefit of having the ability to skip the witness data, because let's say in many light wallet SPV wallets, they don't really do any validation. So with segregated miners, they can skip all the witness data. They just request the face data and make sure it is committed in a block. So it will save the bandwidth of the SPV wallet because they don't validate anyway. And we may also expect that as the blockchain becomes bigger and bigger, some people may just remove the witness data long time ago, like a year ago. You won't really try to revalidate the things. So assuming no one would challenge the validity of the transaction a year ago, because even if you really find a problem, that would be really strong. I think Bitcoin is basically dead. You have a invalid transaction in the blockchain 1 year ago and everything becomes invalid, it won't work, right? But you will still expect that some network will still keep the witness data forever. For whatever reason, yeah. It also enable many smart contracts because many smart contracts require a chain of multi-signature transactions, like I just explained. Particularly the Lightning Network, it is actually also a type of smart contract with a long chain of multi-signature transaction with different time lock, so they can with this kind of I'm not going to talk too much about legendary because that would be another big topic by itself, but it would allow instant confirmation with very low cost. So you know, currently in Bitcoin, zero confirmation transactions are not safe for many reasons, for double spending and also for volatility. But with Lightning Network, that could be instant confirmation, instantly safe, as safe as the confirmed transaction. So we can fully enable the Lightning Network. And we can also introduce new script system in a much easier way. So as an example, we will, in the initial deployment of the segregated witness, we call it the BIP-141. We will have BIP-143, which is basically a bug fix of the transaction validation. So currently in Satoshi's design, transaction validation is actually, if you have a very big transaction, like several hundred kilobytes, it may take more than half minute or even several minutes to validate. It scales n squared, which means if you double the transaction size, the validation time may increase by four times, not simply double. So it is actually a defect in his design. It actually happened last year. A Chinese miner, he mined a very big transaction with 1 megabyte, and that transaction took more than 30 seconds to validate. That would be actually is a very long time, because the block interval is only 10 minutes on average. So a half minute is already is a big problem. And if we increase the block size, say to 2 megabytes, a 2 megabyte transaction could take more than 10 minutes to validate. So it's already longer than the block interval. So with 143, we can fix this problem, but of course, we can only fix the problem. It is fixed only if the people are using Segway. Okay, so if people are still using the old style transaction, the problem is still not fixed. We need other methods to deal with it. And we can also make the fee calculation much easier for hardware wallets and cold wallets. It is also a major complaint for many wallet developers, because currently in Satoshi's design, the signature does not cover the value of the input. So the problem is, if you have a cold wallet, which means it is not connected to the network, it will not know the amount, what is the amount it is spent, because it does not see the transaction. So you have to provide the transaction, the previous transaction, to the cold wallet before it could calculate the fee. So the data transmitted will be a lot, and it is a big trouble for them. And therefore, in segregated witness, we will, in the signature verification, we will also check the value, the amount being spent. So that will make the design of these hardware wallets much easier. And in the future, we may even introduce more efficient signature system, like a Schrödinger signature, which allows you to combine. Even you have like 10,000 inputs, you can combine all the signature as one. Okay, so you only need to validate one signature, even if you have 10 1,000 inputs. So you save a lot of space and save a lot of validation time. So this is the plan after segregated universe is completed. And that will make it much easier. And also for proof system, I'm not spending too much time on it, but in Satoshi's original design, he wants that the SPV wallets will be able to accept warning from the network if there is some problem or some invalid transaction. But currently it is not possible in some situation, like excessive minting, that means some miners trying to create more bitcoins than allowed, or have a very big block size SPV wallet will not see it, or even spending some non-existing input. By introducing a foolproof system, we can make these things providing extra witness data, and therefore the SPV wallet will also be protected much better. So go back to the user experience. We discussed a bit earlier. So let's say if you don't upgrade your wallet, you can still receive payment from any wallets, upgraded or not, through one initial or three initial address. So usually we use a one initial address, but we also have we call it the P2SH address, which is start by three. Okay, and I think most, if not all, wallets would support a three initial address already, and it's sending to a three initial address. So if you do not upgrade your wallet, you can still receive money from both types of wallets. You can still pay a non-upgraded wallet with the existing system, so one initial or three initial address. Of course, you won't have any benefit of SegWit. And you can even pay an upgraded wallet. So back to your question. I'm not upgraded, but the store is upgraded. The store will give me a three initial address, and I will just pay to it. I don't really care what does it mean, okay? Because anyway, I pay it, then the store at honor the payment, then he will give me the product. But I will not enjoy any benefit of SegWit because my wallet is not upgraded. But the store who has upgraded, he will enjoy the benefit when they spend the money later, because the address is actually a SegWit address. Okay.
But if you don't upgrade your wallet and you receive a payment in SegWit, how do you know your procedure?
Again, because when you, if I don't upgrade, I will probably use one initial address. And one initial address are absolutely not SegWit compatible. So let's say I'm not upgraded, you upgraded, I give you one initial
address. What if you give me a three?
Three. Even a 3-1 is still not a SegWit because it depends on the actual content of the address. The three initial is just means it is what we call the P2SH address. The meaning, the actual meaning, depends on the script inside.
But how do I know whether to send you a SegWit or non-SegWit transaction?
Well, you, as a payer, you don't really care, because it's the problem of the person who received the money. I give you let's say I'm selling something to you. I give you an address, and so you just pay it. Whether it is SegWit or not, it is not, you don't really care. As long as you have upgraded, you will enjoy the benefit.
Of course, I imagine it could be slightly confusing suddenly receiving payments that are paid to anyone.
Yes.
Like if I'm getting paid, if I haven't upgraded and I'm getting payments from people who have upgraded,
yeah,
will they send me Segway transactions or regular transactions?
As a regular transaction. It is not possible to send it as a Segway transaction. First of all, you won't see it.
Okay, because I'm giving them one initial address.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, you give it one initial address. Or even if it's three initial address, it is
yeah,
still the same, because we have three initial address even without Segway. The three initial address was introduced 4 years ago already. So so it is actually irrelevant to
yeah, but how if I've got a three initial address in a non-upgraded wallet and I say, can you pay me please, and then you do a Segway transaction, I won't know that you paid.
I am upgraded.
You're upgraded.
Yeah.
And I show you my three initial address.
Have you upgraded?
No.
So I would just send to this address you gave me.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you will see it without any benefit of Segway for you.
Well, what does this transaction look like then?
Sorry?
The thing I'm wondering there is, what does that transaction look like that you're sending me?
It's same as a, well, I'd say, that transaction, if I am upgraded, you are not upgraded, the transaction, you will think that the transaction is coming from an anyone can spend address.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But it won't look like it's going, like it, the,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, it's still going to your address, but it's coming from an anyone can spend address.
Okay. I see.
Yeah, so you will see it and you will spend it, you will be able to spend it later as usual. And if you upgrade your wallet, you can receive payment from any wallet, okay, upgraded or not, through a three initial address. So I assume most wallets would be able to send money to a three initial address. I'm not quite sure if this all wallets are able to do this, but I think at least most would be able to do this. When you spend your money, you will enjoy around 50% of fee discount. So with the same transaction size, comparing with someone who has not waited, your fee is about 50% of them. The actual amount of discount depends on the proportion of minutes data. If you have high proportion of minutes data in your transaction, you will have a higher percentage of discount of fee. So multi-signature transaction will enjoy more discounts, because in multi-signature transaction, you have many signatures, and therefore the minute size will be very big, and therefore relatively you will have bigger discount. And transaction with many inputs but few outputs will also enjoy more discounts, because the outputs is the base data and inputs, which mostly are the signature, would be the witness data. So relatively you will have more discount. And actually this is desirable, because we want to reduce the number of outputs, number of unspent outputs, because it will require more memory to store the unspent output, and therefore we can encourage people to reduce the number of outputs. Yeah.
Where does the 50% come from?
Well, is how to say, because the witness data is not counted to the original block size limit, we have a discount for it. We have a 75% discount for it. So the math is like this. On average, in a transaction, you have 60% of space taken up by witness, 40% taken up by base data. And among that 60% base data, we apply 75% discount, which means you multiply it by 0.25. So 0.25 multiplied with 0.6, so you have about 0.15. So you have 0.15 plus the base data 0.4, so you have 0.55. So that's the discount.
But there are several kind of economic assumptions in that calculation that may or may not be correct.
That should be correct because we make the block size limits that way. So the new block size limit would be, as I mentioned, it would be the base data size plus witness data size divided by 4, smaller than 1 megabyte.
Why? Where does this witness data size divided by 4 or 75% discount on witness data come from? I mean, if we're saying witness data doesn't make it into the block, shouldn't it count for zero?
You mean 100% discount, right?
I'm just wondering, is this a technical aspect of the way this is represented in the transaction data, or is this an arbitrary value somebody has set?
Well, technically, you can have a 100% discount. You don't count the witness size at all. But the problem is that means you will have an unlimited block size because you can put as many data as you want in the witness area. So obviously it won't work. So 75% actually is it comes from Peter Woolley. He designed this number because I think mostly because the I'm not sure if you are aware that in the latest version of Bitcoin Core, there's 0.12, they have a new transaction, they have a new signature verification algorithm, which is about 4 to 8 times faster. So, and therefore he used 4 as the number.
So the new rule will be the base data less than 1 megabyte and base data plus witness divided by 4 less than 1 megabyte.
Base data less than 1 megabyte is always true. Base data plus witness data divided by 4 less than 1 megabyte. Actually, this one, do we have whiteboard or something? So this is the current formula.
Yeah.
Base data less than 1 megabyte. And this will be the new block size limit, base plus witness divided by 4 less than 1 megabyte.
Okay.
And mathematically this one implies this one. Because witness size could not be negative. So this one implied this one. So that would be a soft fork. So technically you may have as much as 4 megabytes here. If you have 4 megabytes of witness data and zero, of course you can't really have zero base data, then the real limit will be 4 megabytes. In the worst case, actually that would be an adversarial attack.
So that's where that 1.7524 megabytes effective
yeah.
block size comes from? So the 4 megabytes is not actually a thing, right?
Yes.
Because I can't have
unless a miner decide to attack the...
But how? I would at least need an amount, wouldn't I?
Well, there are many different ways. They can just put anything they want in the witness space and make it 4 megabytes. Very close to 4 megabytes because the base data could not be exactly zero.
Exactly.
But if it's cool, just to see how long it takes to verify. He does it for fun.
Well, it don't really take a long time to verify. But the problem is it take longer time to transmit. That's the problem. But but we expect that with the historical data, witness data will be around 60% of the block size.
But that doesn't mean we're essentially introducing new consensus rules going forward.
Yes. That's why we need a hard fork.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. This is a soft fork. Of course, we have new rules. We limit the way we change the meaning of some anyone can spend transaction. We change the calculation of block size. But these all are soft forks. Further restriction.
So let's say that demand is low and there's plenty of spare space left in blocks. So will there still be a 50% discount? Because doesn't that discount kind of imply?
You mean that the block is not full?
Yeah.
It may or may not be. It depends how miners process a transaction. If it is, we just assume it is almost full now.
Yeah.
So
that's
the 50% would be really.
So there's lots of economic assumptions in that 50%.
They
might be just completely wrong.
I don't think this is economic assumption. I think this will actually happen because the real limit is here. So the miners will always try to find the transaction which has the highest ratio between the fee and the transaction size calculated by this formula, not the actual size.
It assumes they do that.
Yeah.
Well,
I think that I agree they probably will, but some people.
I mean, you have to make the assumptions that miners optimize for profit.
Yeah.
Otherwise, a lot of things fall down.
Yeah, but it also assumes that blocks are almost full. Otherwise.
Well, yes, I agree. Like, the assumption is there is an actual fight for space.
Yeah.
If there's just space because nobody's using Bitcoin anymore, then I agree that 50% will probably not be realized.
Yeah.
But at that point, you probably also don't care anymore.
If the fraud is not true, I don't think anyone would really care about the fee because it is really, really low and.
Yeah.
Therefore, it's not a real problem. So yeah, I'd say yeah, 50%. It depends how full the block is. So to finish it, I think this is the last slide I prepared. The safety issue. I think many people are also worried about SegWit, saying that it's a very complicated solution. So it is a soft fork, and the upgrade is mandatory for miners or mining pools only. So as a user, you may or may not upgrade it, but if you upgrade, you will have some benefit. So we will require, again, at least 95% of the hashing power to enforce the new rules. We have the experience, and particularly I want to highlight this one, PIP16, which is a P2SH pay-to script hash. Actually, P2SH was also trying to change the meaning of some anyone can spend script. It is not exactly anyone can spend, but when before it is spent, it is not anyone can spend. But if you after you send the transaction out, anyone can take the money because the signature is not could not be verified by the older full nodes. So it's actually quite similar what we are trying to do here is quite similar to build 16.
So just as an academic thought, this does mean though that if I assume SegWit is live and it isn't, and I construct a SegWit transaction and send them to something, it ends up being an anyone can spend.
Yes, yes. So the initial release in the Bitcoin Core, they will not allow they will not allow people to send SegWit transaction. It will still be non-standard. It will not be propagated. So people will not relay the transaction. Only after the rules is enforced by the mining network, then we will have another release of Bitcoin Core to actually allow people to use SegWit safely. So this will be so we have two steps here. First, with miner adoption, then after miners adopted, we will let the users use it. So yes, I think this is more or less I want to talk about this evening. I also have some more slides about the technical details, but probably I'm not going to, unless you want to know more about it. But this one is the new serialization format. So the set which transaction will be related and also will be stored this way. So you have the extra. So you there are some frags here to saying that this is not an ordinary transaction, this is a semi transaction, and you have the extra witness data packed here. Yeah. So this is defined by the big 144. Yeah.
I have one question from earlier slide. The n squared problem with verifying transactions, what happens if you don't implement the bug fix? Was it FIP 143? And then you increase the block size, say, as XT was planning to do? What happens when a transaction takes longer than 10 minutes to
The FIP 143 is only applicable to SegWit transaction. So it won't affect the existing transaction. So you may say the problem still remains, actually. Unless all people change to SegWit, we don't expect it. The original transaction formats will still exist for a really, really long time, if not forever.
Mm-hmm.
And we cannot really disable the original transaction format, because some people may have some time locked transaction we do not know. And if we disable it, we can disable it by soft off. We just it's basically sensor it. We cannot do it. If we are going to further increase the block size, we need to have we need some other methods to deal with it. But at least here with BIP 143, we fix the problem for the SegWit transaction. So if you are using SegWit transaction, you will no longer have this kind of problem.
So what happens though if, like, so say you did increase the block size to 8 or whatever, like, and you had one of these transactions that took longer than the 10-minute average block time? What would happen?
I think even in the current Bitcoin Classic proposal, the BIP 109, it also includes sort of a fix of this problem by limiting the amount of data being processed in a transaction verification. There is some problem with Gavin's solution, but yeah, I think we have to do it still. If we want to increase the base block size, we have to do something like that, although I don't fully agree with his approach.
Well, I understand that there's another approach, but what, just say you just didn't do anything, like what would happen? Like if it took would like the then, blocks would stop being mined or what?
Then you will have, if you do not do anything, just like Bit 101, it does not do anything about the N square problem, then you will expect that you may have some transaction that will take you a few days to validate.
Which means miner wouldn't put them in.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if I would probably put something in my mining software that basically either tries to find these out first and ignore them altogether, or time them out after 5 seconds.
Yeah,
or
the first time you find it, that would be really a chaos, because all the miners will just try to validate, will keep validating the transaction.
Well,
they would just stop.
You would hope that a mining pool at some point has realized that this is a thing that exists in Bitcoin and has put something in their software to time out validations.
Yes.
And basically say anything that validates longer than 5 seconds, which is probably...
But with that approach, that may fork the network. Because if you're just talking about 5 seconds, if you have a better machine, you take shorter time, then you basically create a fork.
So that's why they keep mining on empty blocks before they validate the earlier one.
Could they? Yes,
well,
they may.
In the case of when Wang Chen did it, he was really lucky because nobody was validating blocks anyway. So he expected everybody to mine on top of his block, even though they didn't verify it.
Well,
that was the luck of it.
I don't know. Oh.
Yeah.
Another question. So is the, like, from a best, like, practices standpoint, are people suggesting that going forward, like, people should just use the, like, the set three, like, the editors that start with three, as opposed to the ones that start with one? Is that, like, sort of like a best practices sort of thing? Like, when you design, like, payment software or e-commerce sites, like, you should try to use SegWit addresses.
Yes, I think we will expect more and more people use the P2SH way to do it. But actually, the P2SH... sorry, I don't think I mentioned it. Okay. Yeah, this one. The P142... just for more technical details, but there are actually two different ways to use SegWit. What I have explained is not a native way. It is called a SegWit in P2SH. The advantage of doing this is that will allow non-upgraded wallets to pay a wallet, assuming they support the three initial address. But it is not the really best solution, because it will require extra base data space when you spend your transaction. But it will provide the best compatibility with the existing ecosystem. In long term, we would expect people to use native SegWit, which is more efficient. But with native SegWit, we require an entirely new address format. So people are worrying that they don't want to have another new address format, and therefore we delayed the deployment of Bit 142. But in long term, I think we may still have a new address format.
I still don't understand when an upgraded wallet sends to a P2SH non-upgraded wallet. That transaction, where does the witness data go on that transaction? Is that
No, okay, so let's say my wallet is upgraded, I send to you and your wallet is not upgraded. Actually, it doesn't matter. If my wallet is upgraded, everything I send now
would be a sandwich transaction. No matter I'm sending to a to upgraded or non-upgraded wallet, but so you will see if you are looking at blockchain.info, you will see that the money is coming from anyone can spend address. The problem is for you, if you have not upgraded, you will still see the you can still receive the money. But the problem, the only problem is you won't, when you spend it, you have to spend it in the old style, with the old style, not the new style.
The data doesn't need to be sent, I think, is the answer, right? Because it'll be included in a block eventually, and then you just your old wallet looks at the block and says, oh, I got this money.
Yeah, you wouldn't find out about it when it's unconfirmed, right? You would just surprise.
So yeah, how do you know? Do you see an unconfirmed incoming transaction?
Mm-hmm. Oh.
I think so, because you would reject it. Like, if your node was getting that transaction, it would just reject it as being, I don't know.
Well, actually, if your wallet is not upgraded, what you will see is something like this. You will not see the flags, you will not see the weakness data.
Okay.
So you will just see, I have some money here as input, and the output is your address. So for you, this is anyone can spend, but you don't really care, because as long as this is confirmed by miner, then you get the money.
That's assuming that I'm my upgraded wallet, when I'm spending this, I'm spending money that I got by a recycler transaction.
Sorry?
That is assuming that, like, in the situation when I have an upgraded wallet, I'm paying to a non-upgraded wallet.
Yes.
Of course, I also only have this advantage if the money I got that I'm spending came in via a separate transaction.
You mean, if the input is separate, that means I have the my money is in the Segregated address, then when I spend it, I have to do it this way, to put my signature here instead of here. But when I communicate with people who do not upgrade, I will just gift it to them.
But it's different, right? Because now, if you send me a transaction that's not confirmed,
yeah,
I can still verify the signature.
Yes, correct.
Whereas if you have upgraded and I haven't, then I won't verify the signature. So
you.
So it's worse than a normal zero confirmation.
Because
you don't even know if that anyone could be sending you that money. You don't know if you.
Yes.
That's the same with a zero confirmation. It could be totally fake too.
Yeah, but
you
zero confirmation is unsafe anyway.
Yeah, but you can still see it's valid, right?
Well, it now could be double spent from under you.
In which case, it wouldn't be valid.
Yeah.
Even though I had a valid signature.
It just looks weirder because the money is coming from anyone who spent. It looks even more likely to occur. A double spend, if you have no idea Segwit even exists, and you look at this and you go, oh, this is very likely to be fake, and I'm going to have my money stolen out from under me by a double spend. On this unconfirmed anyone can spend on this unconfirmed transaction I'm getting from an anyone can spend address. Whereas you might say, well, if I'm getting an unconfirmed transaction from a normal address, I trust it more, but you shouldn't trust that address.
Yes, if I see that you have a non-upgraded wallet, I could, by having any kind of wallet, make you think that you have a lot of money, right?
Mm.
In unconfirmed.
Isn't it a slight reduction in security compared to zero confirmation?
Probably.
You have no guarantees with zero confirmed transactions.
Well, and also
from a technical perspective, but I think what you're saying is the way people treat it though is
But that also assumes that if you look at your data, you have not heard of the of segregated witness at all and how these transactions will work. Because otherwise you'll go, well, this looks like anyone can spend, but it's probably segregated.
But the difference is
if you are talking about
you shouldn't accept that.
If you have a full node, not upgraded, actually you won't see the zero confirmation segregated transaction. Because that would be non-standard for you. Segregated transaction will be non-standard for existing full nodes, for existing Bitcoin Core. And therefore, by default, it will not show up in your user interface. You will not see a zero confirmation until it is confirmed.
So there we are again, though. That does that mean that if I pay to a payment provider that hasn't upgraded via a zero, like, I used to do this on Humble Bundle when they still accepted Bitcoin. So they had a payment provider.
Yeah.
They gave me an address. I went into my wallet. I sent them money. A second later, the website went, hey, we got your money. Here's your code. So they accept zero confirms. It's digital goods, so they could revoke them out from under me anyway. But anyway, that would no longer happen if I sent the money from SegWit wallet and they hadn't, and their payment provider hadn't upgraded, because they wouldn't see this thing until it hit a block.
You send them money. Yes.
Well, you would have to hope that all payment providers upgrade.
But as soon as it is confirmed, it will say.
Sure. But what I'm saying is, like, a lot of
coming back online.
A lot of online payment providers have far more immediate feedback for you, basically telling you, we have seen your transaction.
Yeah.
We might not send out your physical goods if they are until we have confirmations. But we'll tell you immediately, payments received should be fine now.
Why is that the case? Why don't they still know the output?
Because it looks non-standard.
Because,
and their wallet says.
Because that's non-standard.
Okay. We deliberately do it like this because we need to protect people excited with that reason. It will... Yeah, for people who accept zero confirmation, that will be really...
Oh, so otherwise I could actually pay my Humble Bundles with other people's money that they will never receive, because I could take any SegWit transaction that I'm not the right SegWit signer for, but the payment provider thinks it's anyone can spend.
Yeah.
So as soon as they're going to see it, they're going to be, that's fine, we're going to give you your stuff now.
Yeah.
And actually I was never able to spend that money in the
it's
first
place. It's much more risky than normal zero. Given that we expect all miners to upgrade, or else we risk the fork.
All miners must upgrade in
what are the considerations to not doing this as a hard fork with a new payment type?
You mean doing segregated miners as hard fork? Why do you think doing it hard fork?
Well, because you just told us now, I mean, it's sort of misrepresented. I mean, it's not just the miners that have to upgrade, all the payment providers have to upgrade, because in reality, that's how they work. I've never encountered a payment provider that waits for 6 confirmations before telling me that I've sent them money.
Well, although I would hope that...
I'm sure that eventually, you know, before they settle it, it is, but like, they at least say, oh, your invoice is paid, we received your Bitcoin. Otherwise, I'm not going to sit on my computer for 6
invoices. I think big payment processors, they will definitely upgrade to SegWit. If they are dependent on SPV wallets, they will probably still see the transaction. It depends on the exact design of the wallet. Doing it as a hard fork, I don't think it will make the thing any better, because
at least this way, it being a soft fork, as long as you look at blocks and not unconfirmed transactions, even if you're not upgraded, you are going to be fine. You are not going to accept anything that the new network won't accept.
Yeah. You're not going to lose Bitcoin any more than you could have possibly lost it before.
If you already have unsafe practices, you could still lose money.
Still run.
If you were already following convention, you are still fine, even if you don't upgrade.
Cool stuff. Hey, yeah. Thank you very much. That was really awesome.
I think I learned a lot too. I find it very nice to actually see the actual thought that went into Segregated Witness and not just the weird current argument that you hear in the media a lot of.
Yeah.
Well, Segregated Witness sort of lets us put more things in a block and that's why it's there.
Yeah.
Which seems weird. But
yeah.
This